Once upon a time, there lived a Roman aristocrat called Gaius Julius Caesar. But his family had declined, and he was prosecuted by a dictator in his youth. He travelled far and wide across the Roman Republic, making a name for himself, until he became the undisputed master of the ancient city. Yeah, like that's ever gonna happen. What a load of... Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. Well, the years start coming and they don't stop coming. Fed to the rules and I hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun. Gaius Julius Caesar was born in 100 BC, a member of the patrician House of Julii, was one of Rome's oldest and most prestigious families, claiming descent from the Trojan Wars and the goddess Venus herself. But the family had fallen upon hard times, now shamefully lived next to a brothel. And whilst little is known about his childhood, we know that he would have learned political skills from his father, who due to his closeness to the general Marius, secured himself the governorship of Asia, as well as the prestigious priesthood of Jupiter for the young Gaius. But following the deaths of his father and Marius, Caesar would align himself with Cinna by marrying his daughter Cornelia, meaning that when Sulla took over in 82 BC, Caesar would not be on good terms with the new dictator, being Cinna's son-in-law and Marius's nephew. The priesthood of Jupiter was confiscated, and Sulla demanded that he divorce Cornelia, and incredibly, he refused the dictator's demand and fled the city. But in a way, he was free. The priesthood, while prestigious, would have enforced a lot of restrictions on the young man, preventing him from riding a horse, seeing soldiers, or even leaving the city for multiple days. In a way, the world was now Caesar's oyster, so he joined the army in the east in the service of the governor of Asia, during which he would go to Bithynia as a diplomat, and rumours that he had an affair with the king there would arise and follow him for life. However, Caesar's fashionable dress sense was popular in the east, so he won the civic crown for his bravery during the siege of Mytilene, and learned about provincial administration. All of these factors left the young officer with a very good reputation, both in the army and in Rome. So when Sulla died in 78 BC, he returned to Rome, and the fashionable young man became a popularis, meaning crowd-pleaser orator, and built up his political reputation, scandalously building a villa, tearing it down immediately, which gained him publicity. He would travel to Rhodes to study oratory, and was famously captured by pirates, asking them to raise the ransom they were asking for, and then following his release returning to kill them, and following this would lead troops in the Third Mithridatic War, before returning to Rome and being elected tribune, then quaestor, then aedile, and finally Pontifex Maximus, high priest of Rome in 63 BC. This would really bring his family out of the hood. He would also support Pompey in his extraordinary command to fight piracy. Following a scandal, he would divorce his wife Pompeia, whom he had taken following Cornelia's death in 69 BC. Pompeia was suspected of having an affair, and Caesar claimed that his wife should be above suspicion, so divorced her. Caesar himself, however, did not have to be above suspicion, having a reputation for cheating widely and often. Following his political career in the capital, Caesar would travel to Hispania Ulterior in 61 BC to take up the governorship there. Alongside sound stewardship of his province, Caesar had a natural knack for warfare, and won victories on behalf of the Republic in northern Portugal, being awarded a triumph, the highest honour a citizen could achieve. So in 60 BC he would travel back to Rome for this, as well as to run for consul, not even waiting for his replacement to arrive. However, largely due to the interference of his enemy Cato in the Senate, Caesar would be unable to enter the city to apply without forfeiting the triumph. So he was forced to choose between the two, and he chose the consulship. Taking office in 60 BC alongside Biblius, a candidate chosen by his enemies to block his reforms. The same enemies had also attempted to stitch him up with a rubbish governorship within Italy itself, where previous consuls are usually rewarded with a rich province from which they can enrich themselves. Caesar would foster an alliance with Rome's greatest general, Pompey Maximus, who would marry his daughter Julia, and in something that was scandalous in ancient Rome, he loved her. And secondly, with the richest man in Rome, Marcus Licinius Crassus. This formed a group of three that we now know as the First Triumvirate.
they would divvy up the provinces of the empire between themselves, as well as attempt to pass a bill that would grant land to Pompey's veterans. This would be passed unconstitutionally, which would allow Cato and Biblius to ruin the reputation of the triumvirate, causing a rift between Pompey and Crassus to form. And following his consulship, owing to the agreement with the triumvirate, Caesar began his first 5 years of governorship in Transalpine Gaul in 58 BC, hoping for an opportunity to restore his reputation and win military glory. And Gaul was the place to do it, with the northern barbarians being the bogeyman that the Romans told their children about, since they had been the only ones to have ever sacked the capital. The opportunity for glory would present itself quickly, when 360,000 members of the Helvetii tribe decided they had had enough of the constant raids from Germanic tribes from the north, and decided to migrate south, through Roman territory. Diplomats reached Caesar to request safe passage, and were sent away so that he could consider it. And when they returned, they got all the answer that they needed from the recently constructed wall, manned by 5 freshly raised legions that greeted them. These armies would mirror the migration of the Helvetii along the Roman border, until an allied tribe would ask for help from Rome to stop the migration. And this was all the reason that Caesar needed to fight a supposedly defensive war. He was happy to oblige.
This is where the fun begins.
Starting an unconstitutional and frankly illegal conflict with the Helvetii, who were quickly defeated at the Battle of Bibracte, and survivors were sent home to act as a buffer state between the Germans and Rome. The legions were then drawn further north by more calls for help from allied tribes that were under attack by the Germanic king Ariovistus. His coalition would be defeated at the Battle of Vosges.
Stop the cap!
Following a desperate chase back to the Rhine, in which Ariovistus valiantly abandoned his wife and children, the harassed German army would cross the Rhine, and Ariovistus would never cross it again. And during the winter of 58-57 BC, rather than withdrawing to his own province, Caesar ordered his troops to construct forts and winter within Gaul. This sent a clear message to the locals that the Romans were here to stay. And why shouldn't Caesar want this land? The Rhine, English Channel, and Atlantic Oceans would provide good natural borders for the empire. Anyway, this realisation would provoke Gaulish defiance against Caesar's now 8 legions as they marched north, with scary rumours circulating amongst the men as they marched, who were now beginning to believe that every warrior in the north was 8 foot tall with biceps the size of Britannia. But these rumours would be stopped by Caesar, who shamed the officers for allowing them to circulate. He'd been writing his own reports, which were being published in Rome, and were greatly boosting the reputation of this great general, who conquered the Belgae in, you guessed it, modern-day Belgium. And when news arrived that his generals had subjugated the rest of Gaul, 15 days of thanksgiving were celebrated in the capital, which was more than Pompey had received for his victories. Relations between Pompey and Crassus had also soured, as they competed for another eastern command. But in 56 BC, the 3 members of the triumvirate would meet at the Lucca Conference and renewed the alliance. Pompey got Spain, Crassus got Syria, and Caesar got 5 extra years in Gaul, with all of them having full military freedom and a combined 20 legions. Until the death of Julia in 54 BC severed the alliance between Caesar and Pompey, and Crassus was killed along with 20,000 of his troops in a humiliating campaign against the Parthians the following year. The triumvirate was finished. But Caesar couldn't dwell on this and was kept very busy in the mid-50s BC. The Veneti would rebel in 56, taking Roman hostages, and the Romans not being a seafaring people to construct a fleet from scratch to fight the seafaring Veneti and their impregnable coastal forts. They would use hooks to immobilise their ships before destroying them one by one, and the tribe was forced to surrender, was punished terribly. He led the first of 2 expeditions into Britain on the basis that they had supposedly aided the Gauls, which whilst brief boosted his popularity when published in Rome, painting him as the man who'd conquered the mysterious land of cannibals and milk drinkers. He then returned to the continent to quell a Germanic rebellion, and in an amazing feat of military engineering, built a bridge in a matter of days, crossed the river with legions, put the Germans back in their place before returning and burning the bridge, which showed them that Caesar could go where he wanted, when he wanted. Then in 54 BC, during a second and slightly more successful invasion of Britain, he was forced to return to quell a Gaulish rebellion this time. This would tie him up for a few years, until he'd have to rally his suffering troops, following their first defeat in his 6 years as proconsul. They would then defeat Vercingetorix's coalition at the Battle of Alesia, with the famous double circle wall around Alesia, defeating both the besieged army and the relief army, and ending the Gaulish Rebellion. And I must say, it's got to be one of the coolest battles in history, Alesia. Big fan. And anyone who read Asterix as a kid will be familiar with the idea of Vercingetorix throwing his arms at Caesar's feet at the end of the battle. But things weren't going well for Caesar in Rome. Pompey had become the first citizen, and relations between the two men had soured. He even refused Caesar's offer of a new bride. Despite his ally in the Senate attempting to pass a bill to allow him to run for consul remotely, Caesar's time as governor, with all of the imperium he needed to avoid becoming a private, prosecutable citizen, was coming to an end, and his enemies were eagerly waiting for an opportunity to destroy the general who had disregarded the laws of the Republic for his entire career. Sides were forming, and in 50 BC the Senate demanded that Caesar disband his armies and return to Rome, a private citizen. But the consul Gaius Marcellus, who unlike his colleague was part of a small faction in the Senate pushing for war, would go to Pompey, and handing him a sword demanded he take up arms against Caesar. Pompey replied that if no other way can be found, he would do it. And in January 49 BC, Caesar's ally Mark Antony, who had won a lot of glory in the Gallic Wars, proposed that both men lay down their arms. The Senate refused and declared a state of emergency. Pompey's troops were moved into the capital, Caesar's allies escaped, and the civil war had begun. The year is 50 BC. Gaul is entirely occupied by the Romans. Well, not entirely. One small village at... Oh no, wait, this is the wrong book, never mind. On the 10th of January 49 BC, Caesar and his army stood on the banks of the river that marked the border between his province and Italy. To cross it would mean there was no going back, and he would have declared war on the Roman Republic. Supposedly stating, "The die is cast," Julius Caesar gave the order to his legions to cross the Rubicon River. And whilst they didn't know it yet, they would bring 460 years of republic to an end.
"You've gone so far over the line this time, you have well and truly crossed the Rubicon."
When refugees arrived in Rome telling of Caesar's blitzkrieg campaigns in the north, Pompey and most of the terrified senators, including the conflicted Brutus, would flee east. Caesar had made a point to be merciful to his enemies, so as to not be branded as a second Sulla, as he chased the Pompeians south, but was unable to prevent them from fleeing to Greece, where upon joining with eastern allies, they planned to cut off Italy's food supply. After returning to Rome and stealing the money from the Temple of Saturn to pay his troops, Caesar crossed the Adriatic and waged a bloody war with Pompey, culminating in the Battle of Pharsalus. After his victory, Caesar would forgive Pompey's troops and Brutus before pursuing Pompey to Egypt. When he caught up with his great enemy in 48 BC, Caesar instead found himself weeping. He was presented with the head of Pompey by the young King Ptolemy of Egypt, who'd had him unceremoniously murdered before he even reached the shores of the magnificent city Alexandria.
"He was a consul of Rome!"
Caesar would set himself up in Alexandria's royal palace, offering to referee the dynastic struggle between Ptolemy and his sister wife Cleopatra.
Cleopatra was black.
The young king would refuse, but after Cleopatra had herself snuck into the palace, where she would seduce Caesar with her intelligence and beauty, months of street fighting commence, culminating in Ptolemy drowning in the Nile, and Cleopatra, pregnant with Caesar's child by this time, was unchallenged for the Egyptian throne. Possibly boosting Rome's influence over the rich kingdom of Egypt, and possibly infatuated with the young queen, Caesar would remain in Egypt for months, during which his son Caesarion would be born, before he would return to the very real civil war. Sweeping through his enemies in North Africa, Caesar would defeat the general Scipio, prompting the suicide of his great enemy Cato in 46 BC, who made himself a martyr instead of allowing himself to be humiliatingly pardoned. Caesar would need to upstage this, so upon returning to Rome and being named dictator for 10 years, he would stage 4 triumphs in a row. But in the last one, mocked Cato's suicide to public disgust. But despite having to fight campaigns against remaining Pompeian forces, he was somewhat accepted as less of an evil than the chaos that his dictatorship had replaced. He held so much power and so many titles that he would claim that the Republic had been reduced to nothingness, a name only without body or substance, most famously reforming the calendar, which had become a political tool by this point, as well as enlarging the Senate in order to administer a much larger empire, and appointing his nephew, Octavian, as his heir. In February of 43 BC, Gaius Julius Caesar was, to the dismay of all diehard Republicans, named dictator for life. But the following month, just days before he was due to leave on a campaign in Parthia, came the day which a soothsayer had warned him about, stating, "Beware the Ides of March." On the 14th of March, he and Lepidus, his deputy, were enjoying dinner, discussing the best ways to die. Caesar reportedly decided on the kind that comes without warning. And on the morning of the 15th, the Ides of March, despite his wife begging him not to, due to bad dreams, Caesar departed for the Senate building, taunting the soothsayer, saying that he was still alive, to which the soothsayer replied that the day was not yet over. When he arrived at the Senate, he was greeted by a petitioner, who promptly pulled out a knife and stabbed the shocked dictator. He would receive a further 22 wounds, lastly from Brutus, a young man who may have been his son, who he had pardoned after the war, reportedly saying, "You too, my child," before covering his face with a toga to hide his last moments, as Julius Caesar died on the Senate floor.
28 stab wounds!
And I will fully cover the repercussions of this cataclysmic event in my next video on the ensuing civil war and the end of the Roman Republic. But the life of Julius Caesar was cut short on the Ides of March by a group of disgruntled senators who believed that they had saved and restored the Republic by putting an end to so much power being held in the hands of one man. And they must have believed that everything would go back to the way it was before. They were wrong. Thanks for watching.
I say,
Hello, and welcome to the history
of
Rome.
That's a nice argument, Senator. Why don't you back it up with a source?
My source is...
Sensua et veni,
por da nostra solum tibi,
por da nostra solum tibi.